You know, this next session is probably the most valuable one for those of us who largely know legislatures only from the outside. One of the biggest challenges in the history of Scholastic press freedom legislation has been translating the process of lobbying for the audience of amateur lobbyists that we have no choice but to come. And we have two people here who I think have a lot of insight. And I'm really excited for you to have the chance to both hear from them and ask questions. So Rebecca Snyder, who you already know, and Frank LoMonte, who you already know, I'm gonna let them take over.
Okay, so Frank and I just now thought, well, how are we gonna handle this? You are gonna receive a handout pack that Mark's sending out, which is really kind of a step-by-step on things to consider as you take the reins and empower yourself and lobby for these bills, because you can totally do it. I just want to provide kind of a roadmap of cautions to make sure that you're getting the most out of the experience. So essentially, when you want to pass a bill, just keep in mind it's easier for things to stay the same than it is to make change. So recognize kind of going into it what you're getting into. And if you think of your job, you are kind of the point person, your combination den mother, organizer, and galvanizer. So your job really is to own the issue, to be the expert there, or to know people like Frank who can be your expert, and to work with sponsors and partners and constituents. And always, if you have access to a professional lobbyist, use them, talk to them, pick their brain, because professional lobbyists are truly on the ground every day working these issues. So we talked a little bit about sponsors, and I do want to pause. If you guys have questions as we go through, feel free, just shout them out. When Frank feels like I'm going off the rails or has something to add, he's going to jump in too.
Meanwhile, I'm live tweeting you.
So we're talking about sponsors, and just kind of picture in your mind legislators. You know, depending on what kind of session your state runs, they could be trying to cram a year's worth of work in 90 days, which happens in Maryland. No matter what, they're busy, they're frazzled, they have a million people coming at them, wanting them to sponsor bills, hearing what they have to say, they're trying to do constituent work. So like these people are exhausted and short attention spans and frazzled. So they may be open to the issue, but other priorities might come up. You know, we've talked a little bit about how this is not putting food on anybody's table. You know, this is making it an immediate problem is going to go a long way. So, and legislators also rely on advocates to push their bills. So even if you have an amazing sponsor, they're an amazing sponsor on a lot of bills, and they really need you to kind of get it over the top. So you have a critical role. So your ideal sponsor is going to be, you know, well-intentioned, understand what's going on, well-respected, has a talented staff, because a lot of the work of a legislator is done by their staff. So having a good rapport with staff is important. And you know, you want them to be convenient and able to respond to you. Like, that person probably doesn't exist all the time. So in all these points that you see in your handout, these are ideals. This doesn't mean like if you don't have if you don't have one piece of it, that the whole thing is dead in the water. It's just, you know, this is best practices, I guess. And when you create a relationship with a sponsor, it's probably going to be your sponsor going forward, because once you have an ally, it's really hard to fire a friend, especially a friend in the legislature. So ideally, that sponsor should be on the committee that's going to hear the bill. And someone earlier was talking that these bills sometimes go to a judiciary committee, sometimes go to education. So try and figure out where your bill's going to land. In Maryland, it didn't land where we wanted it to land. Right. Yeah.
That's part of the question, one of the questions I wanted to ask. Which way is better? Since this is a First Amendment The question I wanted to ask was, which way is better, education or judiciary? Because does it depend on the legislature, or are you going to have more success doing one than the other?
I think it's going to depend on the legislature, don't you?
There's no one right answer to that, and we've seen success both ways, we've seen failure both ways. So here's the first thing I would say is, going in, you should assume that the lobbyists for the school board associations are going to have the deeper relationships with the education committee. So if you have fierce opposition from that quarter, that's where they're going to be the most effective. We had a couple years ago in Kentucky, we had a very good sponsor, a very good bill, but the lobbyists for the school boards had such a stranglehold on their Senate Education Committee that it literally couldn't even get called up for a hearing because they had that much life or death control over bills. If you diagnose that that's going on in your state, then the answer is obvious. Judiciary Committee is where you'd like to be, right? You like to go around that. But if you have a great sponsor who has a seat on the education committee, then I would say education is the way to go, right? I mean, one of the things that we've certainly experienced is people don't like to kill the bills of their colleagues on the committee. And there is a little bit of extra deference that goes to fellow committee members. So, yeah.
And I guess this is also like the first lesson in all of this is, even though you care the most about this and you're so committed, you don't always get to make the choices. So you can hope that it's going to be in education or in judiciary. But at the end of the day, it's some bill drafting staffer who's saying, oh, you know, this fits more with the code in this way. And that's where you go. So, and that'll probably happen in your journey a lot, because also, at the end of the day, your sponsor is in control of the bill. So they may ask you, hey, do you like this amendment or do you not? They could also say, I'm going to do it. And then you have to decide how you want to react to that. So that's just a reality. Once you have a sponsor, you need to collaborate with that sponsor. So again, check in with what they want you to do, because it's like having a demanding boss that needs to look good all the time. So you want to ask them, you know, how can I help? How can I be most effective? It's probably going to be literature drops. It's probably going to be meeting with other legislators. It's probably going to like get the press there, all those things. But definitely loop them in.
Can I just jump on? Because actually Jeff raised this as a really good question earlier about to what extent do advocates start kind of freelancing and going off and doing stuff? Mm-hmm. I would say there are states in two different camps here, right? There are states where there's an identified legislative sponsor and ones that are not. And the ones that are not, go nuts. I mean, right? Fire off all your guns, right? Once you have a sponsor, then I would say you got to take your cues from that person.
Exactly.
And if that person decides, no, not time for the editorial board campaign just yet. Trust me, I've been doing this for 10 years. Wait and let's do it 90 days mm-hmm. from now, right? Then I would say,
Yeah. Yeah. For sure. Some states really emphasize co-sponsors, some not. And it really kind of, you need to know your own state, and this is where be guided by some of the people that are around you. Try and make this a bipartisan issue wherever you can. So when you go before a legislative committee, nobody wants controversy. Nobody wants to have like this big dramatic bill. They want you to show bipartisan support. They want you to have worked out all the kinks, all the issues. You know, nobody wants to have a ton of amendments like on the floor or in committee. They want it to sail smoothly. So what you can do to kind of smooth that path is going to be helpful. And that's where research comes in. So a lot of you had talked that you had tried this bill previously. One of the best things you can do, besides knowing the current landscape of who's for you and against you, is pull the old committee file. Read the testimony that went. You will know. I mean, people don't change their minds that radically, except in North Dakota. Love that. But you will find out what the arguments were last time this bill came up. Try and find out why it didn't move. Was it apathy? Did they run out of time? Was there someone who just hated this bill? And sort of prepare your game plan. The other thing that we talked about was finding those compelling stories. And in your packet, I think you only need a couple, honestly. So in your packet, you have the testimony that we used. So you have just, and this is to show you that it can be super simple, and fewer words are better in these situations. But the backside is our fact sheet, really. So this censorship in Maryland was really situated to say, this is what the problem is. These are real people in real districts who are having this situation, and this is the concern. And then we also wanted to be proactive about some of the opposition, sort of Frank's idea of getting there first, and talking about myths about the new voices. So I selected a couple things that I thought our opposition would crop up, and we just did a call and response of like, here's the myth, here's the reality. Because bills are long, they're hard to read. Even legislators don't like to read them. So this is truly like a synthesized packet to say, this is why you should do it. Here's the problem, here's the solution, and here are real people who support it. So it's part of your compelling stories. And in our censorship happens, at the very end it says, other teachers are reporting these issues but didn't want to go public. And I think that is so critical to say, we have lots of stories, but they're too scared to tell you about them. Or to say, you know, the big problem here is self-censorship. You know, you don't have to have somebody losing their job, but one of the most compelling pieces of testimony we had, in my mind, was a former faculty advisor to a historically black college school newspaper who felt like she had to step very carefully to protect her students, to protect, the standing of the newspaper. And so those types of things, you can talk about, you know, your feelings in the moment without having to have said, and I lost my job and so forth. So keep that in mind. And then the other thing with research is, like, know the mechanics of your session. Are there certain dates? Like, there's usually the last date to file a bill. Mm-hmm. Is there some magic date where the bill has to cross over into the House? Learn how to track legislation, because honestly, you really can lose something just because nobody's paying attention to it, and then you run out of time to vote. It happens, because as someone who runs defense on a lot of stuff, that is a classic way to defeat a bill. It's just, oh, sorry, we ran out of time. Yeah, so, all right. And then I think you have to shape your message. So, and that kind of goes into those stories. Recognize that people's attention spans are super short. So know what you need to say and stay on message. So like, you really are talking in quotes. When you talk to reporters, think about the one thing you want them to write and make sure you say it. You know, don't rely on them because you think that they're journalists to think that they know this issue the way you do. You know, spit out what you want them to put in. And then once you kind of craft your messages, and then you want to share that message. And this is where I like to do a Google alert on my big issues so that I can know what's being said in the press. And that's how we got that one sheet on editorial boards all agree. That's just, you know, I looked at the Google alert and said, oh, here are the people that have written about it. Student press also really writes about this issue. We had a couple, the largest, most in-depth, like really good articles were from the student press world. I use those all over the place. You know, it doesn't have to be the Washington Post. So definitely utilize that. It's important also, just like legislators don't want to read those bills, reporters don't either. So, you know, these one sheets will help you in so many instances because it's not intimidating to get one piece of paper with the bill number on it and say, this is what it's about. Because they'll come and ask you if they need more information. You want to use social media to keep your supporters in the loop. And it can be even like fun things like, oh, we got a new sponsor today, or, you know, the hearing's going to be tomorrow. Just like chatty, informative updates are nice to sort of keep it top of mind. And then don't discount a powerful strategy of making your own news. So you have media statements, press releases, you could do press events. You could have a lobbying day where you bring students in under the guise of civics or to talk about what's important with their legislators. Always make sure you have visits scheduled with specific people. Don't just wander into somebody's office. But be creative on how you would share information about your bill. And then you have to inspire people to act, because the legislators are a piece of it. Constituents are a huge piece of it. So you have your fact sheet, you have your social media, then you have to get people to call or write or visit. And that is, you want to think about when you need those people to do that. Are you guys with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Making sense? Okay. So let's talk specifically about meeting with legislators, because that, for my members, that's a super scary thing to do, because, you know, it's a legislator. They have the power of your bill in their hands. But once again, it really comes down to messaging, being concise, and sort of getting out of Dodge quickly. So you have a sheet on what legislative meetings are and some handy tips. So, you know, it is a conversation, and legislators need to be treated like real people. So ask them how they are, care about what they say. Summarize the issue as quickly as possible, because you're there, you already know what you think, you are there to find out what they think. So give them plenty of room to talk it through, and recognize you'll probably, think 10 minutes is mm-hmm. what your experience has been?
That, like, that's how much time you'll get?
Yeah,
that's,
like,
that's
max.
Probably right. Yeah, that's probably right. Yeah.
So, you know, I would, because they're always on the run somewhere else. Mm-hmm. So it could be that something's popped up and the meeting that you had at 10:30, you'll suddenly have at 11, or they'll need to, and they'll call them on the floor and they need to go. So, like, be prepared for that kind of change in the moment. So you want to summarize what you're talking about, and then remember, you want something from them. So figure out what you want. Mm-hmm. Do you want their support in that committee? Do you just want to give them a heads up that this bill is coming into the larger chamber? You know, are you asking for them to be a co-sponsor? Whatever that ask is, make sure you ask it and that you get that in there. And then if they have questions, you always want to follow up. You know, they have a question. It's, and that seems so simple, but so many people forget to do that. And so you'll find your legislators. Sometimes sit down meetings, like if you've made an appointment, you'll go there. Oftentimes, like if you're at a lobby day or if you're in the halls a lot, most people just catch up with the legislator and do the walk and talk.
Mm-hmm.
It's always critical to know your bill number. Most times legislators aren't thinking about those bills until they're in the committee hearing. Like, that's why when, you know, you're talking, they're looking down and they're like, oh yeah. They're thinking about it then, not really prepping ahead of time. And then on the back of that handout, for my members, I create a talking points sheet because I need my members to stay on message, just like you need your people to stay on message. You don't want someone just wandering off freestyling mm-hmm. when you have lovingly crafted mm-hmm. your message and your plan. And then, you know, make sure that people are comfortable with the mechanics. Like, where do you park? How do you get in? Is security going to take me an hour, or does it just walk right in? And that is, I mean, those are things that get people off their game, and you have to account for it, because in Maryland, Delaware not so much, but like in Maryland, if you catch it wrong, you could be in security for like 45 minutes. You really could. Mm-hmm. So it's something to consider. Do you have anything? I feel like you've done a lot of legislative meetings. Anything to add there?
Yeah. Oh, I mean, You're hitting the really key stuff, I think. I will say, for meeting with legislators, the one thing I would add is presume zero knowledge. Presume zero background on this. I actually remember going around to some legislator office with a journalism teacher whose opening line was, "This just repeals the Hazelwood standard and takes us back to Tinker."
They don't know what that
and,
is.
Right. I was like, that's Chinese. That's Chinese. That's gibberish. Yeah. And I was like, let me show you how this is done. And how it's done, right, is you got to tap into some bigger themes that people care mm-hmm. about, right?
Yes.
And what do they care about right now? They do care about civics. You know, we're having a moment here, right? In many states, a civics ed is now a top drawer concern. And they do care about people being literate in the consumption of news and information, right? Mm-hmm. And so the more you can say, this is a bill that sort of completes the job that you started last year when you passed the mandatory civics test. And the missing piece of that is to enable students to actually discuss issues of social and political concern during the school day, period. No Hazelwood, no Tinker, no nothing, right? That's a nice, simple,
right,
kind of a bumper sticker message there, right? That mm-hmm. where you're trying to get to is you're trying to push two buttons with people. The first button you're trying to push is the button that says, of course, this is motherhood and apple pie. Who could possibly mm-hmm. be against it, right? And that's motivational for most people. Every once in a while, you also need to push the outrage button, but
right,
you have to know which of those to push. It's really good about to read people, right? You mentioned the idea of the anecdotes, and I do think that a little of that goes a long way, because you definitely don't want the taste that you're leaving in people's mouths to be that we're going to war with school administrators.
Right.
You definitely don't want this to be about demonizing evil school administrators, because now you've made this kind of a feel bad issue instead of a feel good issue. And also, people like their school administrators.
Right.
You know, they really, they think, especially, God, those school board members and those superintendents, some of them are very politically influential back home mm-hmm. in people's districts, so you don't want to get crossways with them, right? So if this is like, we're declaring war on bad school
right.
administrators, that's just an uncomfortable place to put these elected officials in. So, right, the horror stories, I mean, if you're gonna have one, A, you better be sure that everybody agrees it's horrible. You know, I mean, that's why Gary's about the shredded newspapers. That's a 99%er right there. There's not like anybody that I've ever told that story to who has said, that seems like a perfectly reasonable response to me, right? I mean, what you want, right? You want that one where the only human response to the story is, that ought to be against the law. That's what you're going for. If you don't have that, then don't lean heavily on the horror story. If you don't have one that's a 99%er that's like, that ought to be against the law, then I would fall back on
self-censorship.
The broader,
that's a
right,
good one too.
The broader concepts of, right, but it's always got to tie back to, I would just, you know, repeat that mantra of social and political issues, social and mm-hmm. political issues. But also, and we'll talk about this in the last panel too, I mean, do be prepared. So there's this great saying that, right, in politics, you campaign in poetry and you govern in prose. And that's what you have to do here. You have mm-hmm. to campaign in poetry and govern in prose. That is, go in and lead with the poetry, you know, right? Why this is good for America, why this is good for education, why this is good for journalism, why this is good for civics. That's what you lead with. But then when somebody gets to the nutsy boltsy stuff and starts saying, well, what does this mean about if the newspaper wants to take the ad for Planned Parenthood? You gotta be ready for that too. That's the prose part, right? You gotta be ready to anticipate that somebody might throw you one of those like lob a live grenade in your foxhole, and you gotta know what to do when that thing rolls in.
And if you truly don't know what to do in the moment,
yeah,
then say, you know what, you bring up a really good point. I want to figure this out a little bit more and really consider that point. I will get back to you, and then get back to them. So it's okay not to know the answer, because you might not, people come up with some really wacky concerns that you've never thought of. But get back to them and say, you know, hey, I want to connect you with an expert who's dealt with this in another state, and then call Frank. you know, so, but there, so there's distancing things to be able to, that you can do. And the other, when you go in, be able to distill what the bill does in like 15 seconds, you know? So it's not, oh, here, let me read you my bullet points of all the things that it does. And at heart, you know, I think these bills even the playing field. which everybody can get behind.
Fairness, that's a, right?
Fairness is a wonderful value.
Yeah.
So, you know, think about what those values are and how you're connecting in. And you, and don't be, you know, you don't have to be inauthentic or disingenuous, because you do believe in fairness. You do believe that students should be able to express themselves and be able to learn their craft. And you do believe in a strong workforce, and that you need to teach the skills that will not only create a strong democracy, but also create their ability to get good jobs later. You know, like, you, everybody believes in those things. How can you not? So I would just kind of be thoughtful about your messaging and have some go-tos if you get into trouble. And they're often like, let me get back to you. Does that sound good with us? Okay. So testimony, that's sort of the next step. So at this point, your bill has been drafted, it's been introduced, it's scheduled for a hearing. You've been talking to some key legislators on the committee that's going to hear the bill. If you have strong allies that don't sit on that committee, it's always nice to check in and be like, hey, heads up, you know, we're introducing this bill again, it's in such and such committee, and, you know, later on, and I'll keep you posted on it, type thing. When it's time to give your testimony, you have to show up. I mean, if you don't show up for your bill, why should anyone care? Now, and it depends, and this is where you'll be working with your sponsor or your lobbyist or someone to kind of figure out how to manage the committee hearing. And it's probably different in different states, so I'll talk a little bit about Maryland because that has a more formal process. So in Maryland, there are specific rules and protocols about that. About when you sign up for your committee hearing, whether you're providing verbal or written testimony, how long you can speak, whether you can directly address people. And so they're a little bit more formal. Delaware, you just kind of go, and the committee basically sits around a table. The advocates sit sort of in the outer ring. And when the group finishes talking, someone will say, hey, does anybody have anything they want to say? And then you say what you're going to say. So that's probably a lot more casual than most people. So I think Maryland might be kind of in the middle. So think about how you're telling this story. And so if you're the one kind of coordinating the testimony from your side, because your sponsor probably is not going to do that. Your sponsor will show up, hopefully. Not always. But if you are managing this, think about the components of the argument that you've developed. So for us, we wanted to bring in higher education. It was partly, you know, who were our big name people, who would be influential, who brings out an aspect of the issue that's important to highlight. So, you know, we had the Press Association, we had a teacher, like a former faculty, who's now in the industry and is a newspaper editor. I think we had a student, I'm not sure.
Yeah, in Maryland. I think we had a live student come testify. We had some written testimony.
Written testimony. And we had Frank as our sort of national perspective, macro level, basically to say, this is happening in other states and nothing bad is going on. And then we were lucky, of course, to have Jamie Raskin, who's a nationally renowned constitutional scholar and free press advocate, to be able to like talk code and to really come up with, you know, is this going to go against any other aspects of privacy or whatnot? So think about, yeah, go ahead.
One of the concerns we have is we're getting ready for this. How do you get this?
Hold on just a second.
Oh, sorry.
One of the concerns we have in New Jersey is we're getting ready for the committee hearings. And I guess we're a little concerned about how you get that all organized and ready when it seems like we might only have like 2 or 3 days notice before we're going to know that we're going to the committee hearing.
Pre-planning is so critical. So, you know, I knock out a lot of my testimony before I ever need it, because like I know what I'm gonna say. So you can have a package of written testimony, and then sometimes, and it differs state to state, so you can let people know, okay, we're at this point in the process. I think in the next week, week and a half, we will go and have a committee hearing. And it might be that your state, and I don't know New Jersey very well, but it might be that certain committees meet on certain days, or so you can say, I think it might be Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday next week. And make sure that your committee, that your sponsor staffer knows that you want to put people together. Because, like, this is their show. That bill, that committee hearing is reflecting on that sponsor. So don't ever blindside them. Because they also, you know, maybe they have another constituent that feels really strongly about this, that they're going to put on. And you don't want it to be just a boring fest of people saying the same thing or being long-winded. So, like, it's theater almost, you know, control it tightly. Because I don't think you win bills by good hearings, but you can totally lose a bill with a bad hearing. So treat it as the theater that it is, sort of the aperitif, to get people interested. And then you have your written testimony where you can go as deep into the weeds as you think somebody's going to read, which is not very far anyway. Give them handouts that they can either get more information if they need it, or really, if you have someone who doesn't show up, because I think we were supposed to have a parent show up in our panel. Didn't happen.
Yeah.
So that's when I think we got that person's testimony a little bit later. Mm-hmm. I followed up maybe a day or two later with everybody on the committee to say, hey, this new piece of information came in, you know, because you're keeping it alive a little bit longer. Does that answer the question? Yeah.
Oh. I want to add, Chief of Staff for Assemblywoman Phoebus told us that the Democrats would not put on something in their committee unless they really believe it would pass.
Oh, good.
So now it's co-sponsored, and the co-sponsor in the Assembly is the Vice Chair of the Education Committee, Troy Singleton. So that's a good sign. Mm-hmm. And so we're hopeful because of that. Now, the question is, again, getting there, getting to it. And our concern, again, is that little bit amount of time. It's not that we wouldn't think that we're prepared, let's say, but to try to get Frank to come in, wherever Frank might be at that any given moment, mm-hmm. and some of the other folks that we want to get there, that's the tricky part, because we will literally have either a Monday or a Thursday, and we'll only have a few days before, and that's the way they work. You know?
And sometimes that's a crapshoot. So, you know, you can bank Frank by saying, I need your written testimony. Here are the issues that I need you to highlight. You can think about who's representing the different points of your argument and at least get written from them. And I have been in situations where people, for a variety of reasons, have been pulled into other hearings or couldn't make it. And what I usually say is, you know, I speak for the Press Association on this panel. So-and-so is going to be here. If they were here, they would have told you. Now, you can't do that for five people, and your panel should never be that exuberant. But, you know, you can do that for one or two important key points. But certainly never read testimony. Just think like your educator, so you know how boring that can be. Think of them as just students that walk out of the room and come back and are reading other things while you're trying to make your point. And make it engaging, make it interesting, and make it digestible.
Rebecca and Frank.
Yeah.
I have a question about lobby days. Mm-hmm. You mentioned that, I think probably Frank, you mentioned that earlier. I recall a few years ago, I was with a team that was on Capitol Hill, and we were lobbying for shield law, national shield law.
Mm-hmm.
And the very things you were talking about were very much the case for us in going door to door, talking to the senators. My question, though, is, are those organized events where you have more time, unlike what he was saying earlier about having a few days to get everybody to show up, mm-hmm. how effective are those, and are the lawmakers really listening or just kind of allowing you to come in and give your time and they've already kind of made their minds up? I mean, what are your thoughts about lobby days?
You know, I don't do personally a lot of lobby days, but I know a lot of like a lot of grassroots organizations do, because I like I'm not wasting my editors on like just gang visits. I do know that legislators want to hear from people in their districts. So you need to, again, it's like this matchmaker, and it's not as effective to, and students are catnip to legislators, like, because it's something about those fresh faces, those earnest, you know, we want to be part of government aspect. So I think if you can, and you would coordinate a lobby day far in advance. You would, like right now, you would say February 13th is going to be our lobby day. Everyone who wants to participate in lobby day, call your legislator and make an appointment, because you don't want to dive bomb and just kind of show up. Then I think they're very effective. But I have also seen lobby days where it's just, you know, like it's healthcare and everybody like goes down to the Capitol and doesn't know what they're supposed to do. And then you feel ineffective and you feel like, and the legislators are like, why are you here? I don't even sit on that committee. You know, so again, think about what you need. Do you need the groundswell of support? Do you need, you know, what are the levers that need to be pulled? Does that help?
So it's more organization on your end.
Beforehand.
Yes.
Because I was thinking about it from the perspective of a lawmaker listening, but what you're saying is, in order for that lawmaker's ears to be open, you've got to do the groundwork to make sure that the people are calling from their district.
Right.
And they know what they've got to go in. Kind of what you're talking about today, the steps that you need to think about before you show up for the meeting, that's on your end for it to be effective.
Exactly. And also, like, controlling that message. So everybody who's going to visit with their legislator, like, they need to know what they need to say, you know? And so there's no shame in like, giving out the sheet to say, okay, Cindy, you're going to go talk to legislator so-and-so. Here's what you say. Here's what you need to do.
Okay. Thank you.
If I could take just a minute at the, I want to share, because I want to keep us on schedule here, just a couple of messaging things, because I do think that we have some good ammo out there. So this is the New Voices website, and I'm going to do a little reorganizing on this, because the to me the most valuable stuff is not really showing now. It's under this tab called Other Resources, and that to me is the most valuable thing. We've got a great library here on the New Voices website of things like the American Society of News Editors has now endorsed this, right? Mm-hmm. The SPJ has now endorsed this. We've got all those resolutions collected on there, and every one of those is something that you can embed as a link in an email to a legislator or to a member of an editorial board, right? We've got various op-ed pieces that I've done, and also op-eds and editorials that other people around the country have done, and that, in addition to being linkable things that you can share, is also stuff that you can draw on yourself if you're sitting there with writer's block trying to figure out, I need to do an op-ed piece for my community newspaper. There's tons of stuff to go by is already gathered here on the New Voices website, so definitely take advantage of that. And then two other things. Peter Bubkowski is here, and his research definitely deserves many shout-outs. This website, civicsandjournalists.org, has several pieces of research about the educational and civic value of student journalism. We're talking about what are our plus points, what are our happy news points, what are our positive points that are not about bad, evil school administrators, right? What this says is, you know, I'm going to super boil down Peter's conclusions, but, right, that students who participate in journalism are more likely to be voters in later life. That's a good point, right? But even better, there's a survey on here of high school journalists in Kansas and Missouri that makes a correlation between working in a newsroom where First Amendment boundaries are respected and where First Amendment freedoms are valued, and having a sense of civic efficacy. That is that I can use my voice to make change, and that people who work in that supportive environment feel more civically empowered than those who don't. And nobody doesn't like civic empowerment, right? I mean, that's the every school says that they are pro-civic engagement. There are whole entire civic engagement departments at colleges now, you know? And you know, that's where, to me, we can say, put your money where your mouth is. You know, this is civic engagement in practice. That's what we're trying to say. Last point, and I've got handouts outside on the food table for everybody about this. Let me grab my visual aid. So I think, and thank you again to Peter and Janelle Belmas of Kansas for helping us put the meat on this. The SPLC has thought for a long time that censorship in high schools in particular was an issue of the disempowerment of girls, that it disproportionately impacted girls and it disproportionately handicapped them in their ability to fully develop their potential as leaders. Again, everyone believes in that. Everyone believes that girls should be encouraged to develop their potential as business and civic leaders. Everybody is conscious that in the news industry in particular, that those executive suites are very disproportionately male, right? So Peter's research has put the meat on those bones and has shown that, in fact, surveys document that girls report being censored at a higher rate than do boys. Girls report self-censorship at a much higher rate than do boys. We've now got this Project Active Voice that is collecting the stories of these girls, including we just did a session at the JEA High School Journalism Convention. That's our most recent post here, where we gathered story after story after story from girls. We did a session that was supposed to be for 60 people. We had twice that many show up, and these kids are mad. These kids are really riled up, and they're looking for a place to put their energies, and this work in New Voices can be a vehicle for those energies, right? Lots of girls in particular get into high school journalism, not because they think they're going to work in a newsroom, but because they're social justice change makers, and so that's energy, that's power to tap into right there.
And yeah, if I may just add to what Frank is saying there, that this is what Gary could not get on the record when he was trying to, and these are stories that Student Press Law Center has had to tell for a long time, but can't really tell for reasons of privacy and retaliation. I was floored when I read this post because you hear it all the time, but you don't get to read it. So it's really good stuff.
We also, just one last thing, we've got a section on the homepage of SPLC called Case Files, and actually Matt Smith's student is in here from Wisconsin, but we've got case files from all over the country of, you know, if you really need the horror story, right, there are horror stories in here, including this is from Matt Smith's school. This is Tommy Kumar, who is his editor. So, we've collected some of the what we think are the most move-the-needle stories where everybody can agree that what was done to these particular students was wrong. We've got Adelina Kalaku's story from New Jersey, Tommy Kumar's story from Wisconsin, and a number of others. So, there's plenty of resources out there for you to work with.
Yeah, and I think it's important to focus on sort of positive change. So legislators come into office wanting to make a difference, wanting to make a change. And so if you can connect the positive values that come as a result of this legislation, you'll get a lot more traction and it becomes more of a feel good. So, you know, you want to talk about what you stand for as opposed to what you're opposed to. It's just a better story. So, yeah.
Can I just emphasize two things from what we did in Maryland that Rebecca touched on? One is message. You've got to craft your message. We never one time in our communications with anyone in Maryland did we say we wanted to overturn Hazelwood. We didn't use that phrase. What we said over and over is that Hazelwood was a very vague decision which left teachers, administrators, and students lost in terms of what they were allowed to do. We talked about the fact that administrators have censored articles and gotten in trouble for it because they don't know what they're allowed to censor and what they're not allowed to censor. Teachers have gotten in trouble and gotten in trouble with their jobs because they don't know what they're allowed to encourage their kids to do and what they're not. And students are completely lost and are self-censoring and aren't covering, you know, good positive things that they should be covered because they're afraid of being censored. So we said our bill was all about clarifying when it was appropriate to use to censor under Hazelwood and when it was not. And the list of reasons we came up with in the bill, I think we were all very comfortable with. You know what I mean? They were things that the Washington Post probably pretty much rules that the Washington Post would have to follow. But having that set of delineated rules made sense, and that worked for us. That worked for us to sell our message. So you've got to craft your message. And the other thing she said, and I have to say it because I was, when we were doing this, I was emailing every night and on the, you know, sending things to people every night. You have to over and over and over say your bill number. We really couldn't do anything until we had a bill number, SB 764. Everything I sent out said, please reference SB. I wrote to newspaper editors, and I would say over and over that SB, I would throw it in every beat I could, every email I sent. You know, you've got to make sure, if somebody writes a letter to the editor and they don't say that bill number, it's wasted effort. And so I spent, you know, those months just SB 761. My final words on my deathbed will, I'm sure, include the phrase SB 764. So that's what I wanted to say. Thanks.
It is funny, like, you get to know all those bill numbers.
Yeah. Given what you're saying about positive messaging, I know up in Vermont people are going to be talking about threats to the First Amendment based on the new person who's going to be in the White House. Would you recommend steering the conversations away from that to keep it positive, or to engage in that to say, yes, we want to get these in place to protect students?
Well, you know, Vermont is it's Vermont. So, you know, I think that I would talk about engaging and how important it is to live your values and to engage in democracy. So I don't think I would be like, oh, this is anti-Trump or anything like that, you know, but this, because you will have, people voted for Trump. So you will, you know, those making kind of that incendiary argument is not going to help you. But if you can, you can talk about how important it is for students to feel like they have a voice, that they have direction over their lives. You know, those are things that sort of obliquely might reference some of the problems that we're seeing in press freedoms nationally, but they're all things that people can get behind. So I would still stay positive. And I would also, that goes true for your opposition. You have to find the positive value in every opposition, because even though they disagree with you, they're not bad people. They have, you know, so those school boards are thinking, we need to have order, we need to keep people safe, we need to do whatever they think they need to do, and you need to honor that, because no one likes to feel like they're failing, but some of the best compromises or bills that I've worked on have been when I've deeply engaged with opposition to find out what's important to them, and then we both figure out a way to get through that. So I would stay positive.
I want to follow up on what the fine gentleman from Maryland said in regards to messaging it in terms of bringing clarity to something that does not have clarity in that law. And we talked about that in Minnesota too, and one of the things that I want to know is, as we look at the legislation and we say it does place limits on student speech, it does create some parameters, is that an effective messaging tool as well to say this is a tool both for students and for administrators, and this is something that protects both of those groups because it has limits and boundaries for students that I think most of us would, the limits that have been applied in most of the languages that I've read, I think most of us would say that's within the bounds of what we would agree is should not be published.
Yeah. You know, honestly, I don't want, you know, just dreadful things being printed in the school newspaper. That doesn't serve anybody. Like, the school newspaper is a safe sandbox to learn a craft. So it doesn't have the same, you know, like, they're not at the local metro. You know, they are learning how to engage here, and you need, and I think pointing out that there are kind of like, you know, borders around this that everyone feels comfortable with is important, and an acknowledgement that, you know, students are learning, and so they're gonna make mistakes, they're gonna make poor choices, but really the point of education is to create those safe spaces where they can make mistakes and learn from them and become better at what they're doing. If you don't ever give them the chance to fail, you never create an opportunity to succeed. And that is, I think, a really, because it hits home when you're talking to legislators or just people in general, like, a lot of people have kids. You know, a lot of people remember what it was like to be in those situations and recognize, oh, you know what? This is a way that we can really make it better. And I think that's helpful to emphasize.
So one way to frame it might be, this provides a context for discussions. This is an area that is wide open right now, and there's a lot of ambiguity in the law.
Mm-hmm.
And I know when they did research in our state, they were largely pulling up Hazelwood case law and saying that, well, this is the law and these are the areas. But it's still, Hazelwood still leaves a lot of ambiguity.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, so I've certainly used the point, and I'll just borrow this from the time that I was going to spend with Ken, because this is what I would have said in that portion. I have used the argument before that, right, this clarifies the state of the law so as to more expediently resolve disagreements, right? Mm-hmm. That right now you're reading the tea leaves of what a federal judge might or might not decide is protected speech based on 25-year-old case law, as opposed to if you've got this statute, you've got a checklist. Mm-hmm. And this simplifies dispute resolution because you just pull out the checklist and you say, does it satisfy one of these five exemptions? If so, the school wins the argument. If it doesn't satisfy those five exemptions, then the student wins the argument. And so I think, right, as a tool of dispute resolution that, right, you can try to frame it up as this is actually something of an asset to schools. I mean, I don't think you can overplay that, right? Because the schools are going to come in and say, no, thanks, we don't want this asset. We're fine with the assets we have right now, right? So you can't, you can't oversell that point. But
you can say, you know, like that poor overworked principal who has to deal with everything, you know, now doesn't have to, like, pour through the student newspaper and think, okay, are parents going to be angry because the word damn was in there, or, you know, whatever their markers are. I mean, it is a clarifying thing that could be seen as a helpful tool. Mm-hmm.
We've got time for one question. Kathy?
Or Vince, either one of you. Not that you speak as one, but, well, actually, we can let both of you ask your question.
Well, I really do want to stress the importance of the fact that this type of legislation protects school districts, and we've got two cases in our state that come up. One of them hurt us last time because a school district was sued for content in student media. Both cases went to were appealed. But they did find in favor of the student journalists. The interesting thing, though, was that in both cases, the student media in question had operated in practice as open forum. And so the students had been making all the content decisions. And that did come up in court. And it wasn't the deciding factor. Basically, the deciding factor was that there was no malice on part of the student reporter and that they really had done their job to the best of their ability. When these cases come up, I'm really happy to hear what you just said about how, yes, you know, this does happen. People get upset, get angry, and sometimes they might sue, but this legislation really does provide a protection to school districts from being sued for content that the students have generated. So,
Okay.
I'm sorry. I know you're out of
it. That's all right.
Well, I'll just add to that, that not only does it protect the school districts, maybe even more relevant, it protects taxpayers. Because ultimately, for example, the Puyallup School District had to spend quite a bit of money to defend itself, even though technically the plaintiffs were suing the wrong people. They probably should have been suing the students, but there's no money there. So this at least the legislation in our state makes it really clear what the limits are of that. I was just going to ask a question about the role of our state association, and whether we can, as a nonprofit, how active we can be in terms of addressing
legislation. Why don't you hold that to the next session? That's perfect transition for us.
Thanks.
Thank you, Frank and Rebecca.